So let's take a little bit different view of this same problem. So what I want to do is draw a graph here showing the level of code coverage that our random test cases are inducing on the system under test. So again, we're testing a web browser. And on the x-axis, this is going to be a little bit fuzzy, unfortunately, but what I want to show is how far into the web browser we execute, which is just checking, for example, if the incoming data is even valid HTTP. Once we get valid HTTP, the browser is going to scan and make sure it got valid HTML. It's going to be doing lexical analysis and checking of HTML. If the input fails to be rejected by this kind of code, it's going to go onto the rendering engine. And finally, we might have sort of some more advanced processing that's dealing with things like forms, cookies, scripting, and such. Okay, so we have this graph. So now let's see what happens when we fuzz the web browser using totally random bits. Well, what's going to most likely happen is most of those bits that come in are not even going to be valid HTTP responses. So we're going to get coverage that rapidly drops off. And what's left is almost always going to fail somewhere else. So what we're going to see is we're going to spend the bulk of our testing effort rejecting random sequences of bits very early on, and very little of our testing effort testing code here. And so again, as I said, if that's what we're trying to do, if we really want to be stressing the early parts of the web browser code, then that's great. And random testing is perfectly good at that. But on the other hand, if what we're interested in is sort of broad coverage of the software under test, then we're going to fail. So the red color indicates random bits. The next thing we could do is we could rig our random input generator so that it respects the constraints of the HTTP protocol. Furthermore, we could adapt it so the text that it generates contains valid lexical elements of HTML. That is to say, it's composed of things like braces with tags in them, other kinds of text, other sorts of directives. So this isn't too hard to do. So if we do something like that, and what I'm going to call that is use green to represent protocol correct code. I'm using sort of fuzzy terms of my own devising here, not trying to use any kind of standard terms. So now what's going to happen is hopefully we'll get pretty good coverage of the protocol code still. We should get quite good coverage of the lexical HTML processing, and we're going to fall off a cliff again. Because as soon as we get into the renderer, it's going to become apparent that we didn't try hard enough to generate valid HTML, that we're going to get something to render very often. So now what have we accomplished here? Well, we've pushed the coverage that we're getting on the software under test farther into the system. It is farther into the HTML processing chain, but still haven't pushed it very far. So the next thing that we can do is use some sort of a grammar or some sort of a structural definition of HTML to generate random but valid HTML. So the next thing is valid HTML. And so what's going to happen now is our coverage of the protocol code and the lexer may decrease, but on the other hand, we're going to be able to push into the HTML processing code quite deeply before falling off a cliff. So what have we done? We've traded off coverage in the early parts of the web browser, which may well be so simple that we don't care that much about them, for coverage farther in. And so finally, what we could do is generate random code that includes elements of scripting, forms, whatever else it was that we're interested in testing, and we can run that through. Now we can start randomly testing our browser with this. So what's going to happen now is our coverage might decrease even a little bit more in the early parts because we're spending more time doing other things, but we're probably not going to fall off of a cliff at all. And so you can see that in most cases when we do random testing, what we're looking for is something like this kind of flat line. And what this flat line indicates is that we're covering all parts of the software under test roughly equally. What we're going to see is, as we look through more random testing examples, is that getting sort of a coverage curve like this often requires quite a lot of work, quite a lot of sensitivity to the structure of the input domain, but that on the other hand, we get paid back for that work with random tests that can exercise the entire software under test, and that's going to be a valuable thing in many cases.